Welcome to Retouch Pro Live, the only live show dedicated to retouching and post-processing. I'm your host, Doug Nelson. We'll be speaking with Steve Caplin in just a moment about navigating within Photoshop's 3D interface. But first, some quick announcements. Let's see. First of all, the title card you're looking at. This week's winner of the title card contest is Terry Miles. So congratulations to Terry. Applause all around. First of all, I thought this was a striking image. I really liked this. But I also wanted to point out the layer stack. RetouchPRO.com is devoted to instilling good habits and good practices for professionals and aspiring professionals, although granted we have a lot of enthusiasts and hobbyists in there. But that's always been the core thing. And I mean, although it's a relatively simple layer stack, I think he did a marvelous job. Consider, you know, a layer stack that you're handing off to a person that's never seen the work before. Look here. He has included here the name and a link to the source of his original image. In this case, it's imcreator.com. Thank you for the use of that. He's got the steps that he did. He did a pretty good job of renaming his files. And he even included a blank layer here with a note on here, giving his full name and the username he goes by on RetouchPRO.com. And so I just wanted to point this out. First, you know, again, wonderful job, Terry. Thank you very much. But also, I just wanted to point out that layer stack as an exemplar of the way, you know, if you're going to hand off your work to somebody that has no idea what you've done, that is a very good way of approaching things. If you would like your image to be used on some future Retouch Pro Live show, please enter our title card contest. I'll paste the link in right now for you to bookmark later. The prize, quote unquote, is if I like your image, I will use it on some future show. And plus, it's fun. You get comments from other users. You learn some tricks. You get to refine your things. It's an educational process. It's fun for all. So please enter. Plus, I'm running low on these things. I need some more, please. Let's see, you're going to want to know how to interact with me and Steve today, the questions panel here. If you don't see it, click it, drop it down, type your question or comment here, hit send. Let's test this out. Let's do a question for today. Today's question is relevant. They always are relevant, but today's is especially relevant. I want to know, what's your 3D experience been like? Do you have no 3D experience? Are you an old salt at Cinema 4D and Modo and all those wonderful things? Have you maybe piddled around a bit in Photoshop's 3D back in the CS6 days or whatever? And how's it been for you? What's been your sticking points? What's been the areas you'd like to know more on, whatever? Because if today's show is going to be very rudimentary, for my benefit, and it's not presuming anyone's knowledge in the audience, I asked specifically for this show. If there's enough demand, and if we get enough good suggestions or whatever, we might do future shows on, oh, I don't know, rendering or lighting or just whatever. But again, that will depend on the comments we get right now. While you are doing that, let me tell everybody that we actually have a 3D forum over at RetouchPRO.com. It's right here, the 3D and Synthetic Imaging Forum. I will do you a favor and paste that link in right now for you to bookmark for later. So please check that out. You can post your work there. You can post questions. You can post useful links, useful resources, anything like that. While you are at RetouchPRO.com, you should check out our videos. Go to the site nav, go to Retouch Pro videos, or just go to RetouchPRO.com/videos and check out the various and sundry videos that we make available for rental. Now, most of these are, I basically hired some of the best retouchers in the world to retouch an image while we watch and ask questions, and they explain every step along the way. So you're basically have the opportunity here of looking over the shoulder of some of the top in-demand retouchers working today, starting with the before, working towards the after, step by step by step. Some of these are, granted, are close to 3 hours long, but you can pause them and rewind them and things along those lines. We also have other shows, technique shows. Steve Caplin, for example, has 4 pages of shows here, showing going in deep on just about every possible core technique in Photoshop, the pen tool, selections, masking, things along those lines. And we have other presenters showing techniques of interest as well. We've got color correction and printing and things along those lines. But most of the shows are about basically real-time retouching, beauty retouching, jewelry retouching. We even have some old photo restoration and things along those lines. Step-by-step, real-time. Please check those out. RetouchPRO.com/videos. And again, while you are there, please consider being a patron. Go to the site nav, click on the patron. This is what pays for Retouch Pro Live. The show you are watching right now only exists because of the previous people that were kind enough to click on this link and to agree to be a patron. If people stop doing this, the show will no longer exist. It is that simple. It is very expensive to do. I cannot continue just paying for it out of my own pocket. My pocket is only so deep. So if you would go and become a patron to guarantee the future of Retouch Pro Live, and also perhaps even expanding RetouchPro.com, adding new features, moving to better servers, things along those lines, it is all dependent on the patrons. Tell you what, I will paste that link in now for you to bookmark that for later. It's a simple equation. Patrons equals more Retouch Pro Live shows. But let's get on with the real show now. Steve Caplin is a photo illustrator. That's a term that he and I mutually negotiated, based out of England. You can buy his books. He's got How to Cheat in Photoshop, but he also wrote a book on 3D in Photoshop. Perhaps, I don't know, that'll be up to him whether he wants to mention that or not. He is also a prolific producer of videos over at lynda.com, and I know he's got some 3D ones up there, so you might want to check that out. Lynda.com will pardon me if I do not paste that link in unless they want to pay to be a sponsor for the show. Okay, give me a second here. We'll turn it over to Steve's screen. There we go.
Hi, Doug. How are you doing?
Welcome, Steve.
Good to be back.
Now,
You're right. We did agree to negotiate photo illustrator. It's a term. It's okay, photo illustrator. I tried originally to call myself a digital artist, but I couldn't say it with a straight face.
So I'm trying to find something. Everybody's a digital artist nowadays. Eminem is a digital artist. Steven Spielberg is a digital artist.
It doesn't mean anything, does it?
Because everything's digital.
Everything's digital, exactly. Anyway, so here we go. 3D Photoshop. And I know it is... It's a really confusing area, and now that the 3D part of Photoshop is bundled in, it used to be an optional extra. You could pay for the extended edition of CS5, CS6, and you would get your 3D, but now if you have a subscription to Photoshop CC, then you get 3D, the 3D tools automatically. And still, people are kind of scared of them.
You know, I am terrified. I mean, in preparation of this show, people should know that you've been not so quietly mocking me for how intimidated I am about this. Because for you, it's dead simple. But of course, for you, all of these things are dead simple. That's why we have you on these shows. But I tried it again, and sure enough, I got lost. I tried a really simple thing, just with a really simple object, tried to move it around a little bit, and suddenly I was way over here looking down at something that I could barely see, and it had turned into a gray blob, etc., so forth and so on.
Okay, well, let's get going. We're going to start off, let's make a piece of text and let's call it I've got to do about, not the whole Retouch Pro, let's just call it Pro. There we go, it's a little small, so let's make that quite a lot bigger so we can work with that. And we're going to turn this into a 3D object. Now, before I do that, this is the standard layout, the standard workspace. Well, there's a workspace that I've adapted. I like to have my color at the top, my lot of space for all my layers, and then all these other panels that can pop up as and when I need them at the side here, and just bring them out and put them away. When I'm working in 3D, Photoshop, if you switch to 3D, it will say, do you want to switch to 3D workspace? You can say, yeah, go ahead, and it'll take you into this. And this is the standard Photoshop 3D workspace. Now, because I have a widescreen monitor, I think it's worth giving up a little bit of screen real estate to have this, which is my 3D workspace, where I've got the 3D panel and the properties panel on view. When you're working in 3D, those are the two essential panels. But I also like to have my my layers file on there, because my layers panel, why have I got that in a group? It shouldn't be in a group. You see, you can spot things like that when you have your layers panel visible. And so I've just given up a bit of a couple of inches of my space just to have the extra panels always visible there.
Okay.
Just the way I like to work. Let's go ahead. We've got this 3D regular text here. We're going to make sure I've got a 3D extrusion checked is what I want to do from the selected layer. I'm going to go ahead and say create. And there we go. It immediately turns this into a 3D object.
Okay, my pulse just jumped. The adrenaline is now flowing. I am now afraid.
Take several deep breaths. Have a couple of Valium. We'll soon calm you down and get you back on track here. So, there's a difference in 3D between moving the model that you're looking at and moving yourself. It's like you're taking a photograph of a chair in a room. You can move the chair or you can move yourself around the chair. And this is something people get very confused about. While this object is selected, you can tell it's selected by the bounding box. If you just click and drag, well, it's going to move that object around. We often don't want to do that. If you click away from it so that there's no object selected, if you click and drag now, you move the world around. Okay? You move your camera, your viewpoint. So that is the key difference to remember. The difference between moving your viewpoint, moving the camera, in other words, and moving this object.
Okay.
So if you're in, if you have Photoshop CC, that one of the really nice innovations, it's quite a small innovation, is even while you've got your object selected, down in the bottom here, if you look at the bottom left of the screen, you've got these three tools for maneuvering the world. So if I drag on here, even though the object is selected, I'm still moving that camera around.
Okay, it says orbit the 3D camera.
That's the orbit tool, and it's kind of a free rotation tool. You can drag it as you like. Next to that is the pan tool, and this moves it left and right, up and down. And next to that is the dolly tool, which brings it forwards and backwards. And it's not the same as a zoom tool, because what you're doing is not making it bigger. You're moving yourself closer to it. So, for example, if you look at the P, you can see the extrusion on the bottom of the P goes up. It comes up here and it goes in maybe a third of the way around the curve on the edge of the P.
Okay.
As we dolly forwards, we bring that closer and you can see it's not simply enlarging it, it is changing our perspective viewpoint on it, just as it would if you really got closer to something. So that's kind of key. The perspective changes, the further away it is, the more the verticals are truly vertical. The closer it gets to you, the more these vertical edges diverge, just as they would in real life with any regular object.
Okay.
Okay. So for moving the camera around, these are the main tools you're going to want to use. We can drag up and down, left and right with the pan tool, in and out with the dolly tool, and with the orbit tool, we can just drag to rotate the whole thing.
So if we wanted to be like down looking up at it, we would use the orbit tool.
Exactly. And we bring it down like that, except we're looking from, well, beneath the ground.
Okay.
So that's what this grid we're seeing is the ground plane. If we want, we can go to the 3D menu. No, we go to the view menu. Under extras, we can choose to show the ground plane. We can toggle that on and off. I've actually written Control G as a little shortcut to turn the ground plane on and off.
I think that ground plane might actually be one of the things that I've been missing. Does that default to on or does that default to off?
It defaults to how you last left it. If you have never used 3D in Photoshop before, then it'll be off.
That's probably been one of the key stumbling blocks in my own education on this area.
Possibly, yep, could well be. Well, that's a thing to do. Certainly turn on that ground plane. If you like, you can also look at the secondary view. And we'll turn that on a little bit later when we come to combine two objects. Mm-hmm. For moving the object itself, so it's now selected, and you can see it's selected because of this bounding box. Mm-hmm. As you roll over the bounding box, you can see if you want to go over the front face, it highlights with this orange tint over it. Mm-hmm. In fact, I'll tell you what, let us change the color of the object itself just so it's not orange, that we can see the orange tint more clearly. So it's selected. There's the tint over the front face.
Okay.
And if you drag, when that front face is selected, you can see it says move along. I'm going to call it the Z-axis because I've always called it the Z-axis. You can imagine I'm saying Z-axis.
We'll do that. And I already did.
Okay.
So I always translate when you speak.
Excellent. And as you drag up and down, it's now moving it just along that axis.
Okay, Z-axis, if we remember our days of from geometry, the X-axis is left to right, the Y-axis is up to down, the Z-axis is further away and closer.
That's absolutely right. Unless you're talking about 3D printing, in which case the Z or Z-axis is up and down. But that's another show. So, on that face, on the left face, you move it on the x-axis. So we're just moving it purely left and right.
Okay.
Yep. And on the top, as you expect, the y-axis, you can move it up and down. You can see when it drops down below the ground plane, you can see how the ground plane very neatly wraps around it. So you can see just how far below the ground plane it is.
Okay. With you so far.
Yep. Good. So that is one way of moving things around. Let's talk about rotation. If we go over a corner, we can now rotate. And as you'd kind of expect, it rotates around the axis parallel to that corner.
Okay.
So with a vertical corner, it's going to rotate it around the y-axis. Yep.
Okay, so it's going to rotate around the vertical axis.
Around the vertical axis. If you go over a horizontal edge,
sure.
It's going to rotate it around the x axis.
Okay, the left to right axis.
Left to right axis. If you go over one of these ones going off in the distance, it's going to rotate it around the z or the z axis. So that is reasonably intuitive. When a corner is an edge is highlighted, it rotates around the axis parallel to that edge. You can also go outside it and just rotate it freely.
I think that might be where that I've always done and why I always get lost.
That is where you're going to get lost. Now, there are times, let's say we've got our viewpoint like this, and what I want to do is to slide it to the left. Well, the trouble is, the edge I need to get, I can't reach because it's hidden on that side and it's hidden on this side. So how can we slide it on the x-axis when both the x-axis planes are hidden from us? Well, that's what you've got this little controller in the middle here for. This 3D controller lets you rotate, scale, and drag your object. And there's a handle here for each of the axes. So on the end, the little cone is for moving it along that axis. So I can move this right and left by dragging on it. You can see that cone is now highlighted. Next one down is the rotation tool. And as I, when that's highlighted, as I drag, it's going to rotate it around on that plane.
The same axis, though.
So it's actually rotating it around the y-axis, but it's rotating it on the x-plane.
See, now, okay, now so, that's an important distinction there, because I think, again, this is another area that mixes people up, because it did just switch from x to y.
Well, it kind of, but it's really quite logical. So the cone on the end, that moves you on the x-axis, left and right. Next one down, you can see the circle coming out. And that circle shows you the plane that it's going to rotate on. So it's on the x-plane. It's rotating it on the x-plane, which I guess means rotating it around the y-axis. If we go to the y, then the cone at the top moves it up and down. The next one down, there is your circle again, and that's going to rotate it around that Z or Z axis. Now, this is the axis relative to the object itself. So if we turn our viewpoint around, like this, this is still going to move it on the X axis. Missed. There it is on the end. But that's the x-axis relative to the object, not relative to the world.
Is it like a line, an imaginary line going through the center of the object?
Going through the center, but it's an imaginary line based on the bounding box around this object.
Okay, not necessarily the object itself, but the bounding box.
That's right, yeah.
But now, when you rotated that, it did not rotate the way I expected it to. I expected it to spin around the ground plane, but it rotated in space a few feet or inches or whatever our scale is above the ground.
No, I was not rotating. I was sliding it. I was moving it. And you can see the little pop-up help coming up. So is that what you mean? That one?
Go do the green one. What do you? Even terminology is even escaping me here. And the
y-axis controller.
And the rotate.
Okay, that rotates it around. It's actually rotating it around the z-axis, but it's rotating it on the y-plane.
But is the axis on the ground plane, or is the axis up in the air?
The axis goes with the center of the object.
Well, it is up in the air, essentially.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And you can spin it all the way around like this. Now, it's very easy just to get completely tangled up and think, okay, how do you get back to where you started?
It's almost better than easy. It's almost inevitable.
It is indeed absolutely inevitable. So what I tend to do is I use all these different controllers to get the object more or less where I want it. So let's say we've got this and we want it lying flat on its back. So we're going to kind of rotate it around like that and then bring it around like that. We can take the extrusion down. I don't want it quite as deep as this. So you take it down something like that, and you think, okay, I want it flat on the ground. How do I know when I've hit the ground? How do I get it straight? Well, the answer here is you stop messing around with all these on-screen head-up controls, and you have a look at the numbers. So now, in the properties panel, you've got all these different controls. You've got the extrusion depth is the first batch. Then you've got the twist and taper and the bend and shear controls. Next batch you've got is the beveling and the inflation. And the final one is the coordinates. And this shows you exactly what you're working with. So we can say reset coordinates. And that puts it back, puts everything back to zero.
I think I like the one below that even better.
Move to ground, exactly. And now it is standing flat on the
ground. Because look,
we
never did that. It's you just reset coordinates, but it moved to a place that we never had it.
No, that's right. Because when you reset coordinates, it centers everything. So it centers the object on the
axis. So it's not actually resetting
the axis.
It's putting it to new coordinates that we never inputted.
You're right. It is putting it into new coordinates.
Ah, point Doug.
No, you're absolutely right. It's doing that. So we need to then move it to the ground. We now want to rotate it, so I can start rotating it and say, yeah, that looks roughly right. When I look at the numbers, I can see, okay, here we go. The X rotation angle is 73.5 degrees at the moment. Let's highlight that, change it to 90 degrees, and now we know it is perfectly parallel to the ground plane. Now we can just hit move to ground, and it drops it straight onto the ground.
Now, if you've got it at some other angle and you hit move to ground, will it straighten itself or will it move to the ground and still stay at that canted angle?
It'll stay at that angle. So let's move it up a bit and let's rotate it kind of like that. If we now do move to ground, it will move it so that the front edge is now touching the ground. And if we turn the camera around, you can see there are the shadows coming off it.
So the really
So
there
those
there
are.
really is no command to just drop this thing on the ground flat.
Yeah,
I
you
remember,
can just say 90 degrees and now drop it to the
I
ground.
meant like a button or something. I remember Poser has a button that you can just whatever is in the air, you can just hit the button and it just drops flat on the ground as if the ground was made out of concrete.
That's what move to ground does, but you have to tell it what angle you want it, because remember it started off standing like this. And you're saying drop it flat, and it's saying, yeah, I'm dropping it flat. And you're saying, no, I want it drop on the flat on the ground. It's saying, I've got it's flat on the ground. What more do you want?
I wanted to read my
If you want a
mind, of
different
course.
angle, you've got to tell it, I want a different angle. There's my different angle, 90 degrees. Now move it to the ground. And it's saying, all right, why didn't you just say that in the first place? So, it tries as hard as it can to figure out what's on your head. It doesn't always get it
Could
right.
try harder. I swear it could try a little harder.
It could try a little bit harder. So this is really key. You can kind of ignore the most of the controls. So the scaling control, this is currently 3511.88 is the X size in
That is
pixels.
pixels. Okay.
I have no idea what that means. It clearly isn't the size in pixels, because we're looking at this at 100%, and our total image size is only 1980 pixels wide. So these dimensions are largely irrelevant. I would frankly ignore
They're
those
mostly for like
dimensions
just
entirely.
relative to each other is really about their only importance.
Yep. The most important thing is the angle controls in here. What you can also do, I mean, let's say we, okay, let's have a look at the rest of the controls in the middle. The middle yellow box scales the object, makes it bigger and smaller, scales it uniformly. We didn't look, is that we had the move control, the rotate control, underneath that is this little box, and that is the scale control, so now I'm scaling it only on the Y axis. Now, when you do this to a font, particularly a sans serif font, it just looks awful. And I don't recommend that anyone ever does this to a font, because it destroys all the rules of typography. So we want to undo that, but we don't want to undo the fact that we've rotated it. Well, rather than resetting all the coordinates, we can reset just one row of coordinates, one column. So by hitting this button, I can undo that scaling, but we don't undo the fact that we've rotated the object to lie on its back.
Okay, I think I understand it now.
Yep.
So now,
How's this looking so far?
whenever we scale something, we are scaling it in absolute numbers based on its bounding box. This has nothing to do with its angle of rotation. It has nothing when scaling has nothing to do with the ground plane.
No, absolutely.
Cool.
In fact, the object has nothing to do with the ground plane. The object and the camera are two completely different things.
Think that might be one of the elementary mistakes that I'm making whenever I'm approaching this.
It is something that does confuse people a lot, but they are absolutely different. You can move things around, move your camera around as much as you like, and you just view things from a different angle. The object, no, that remains independent of what you do with the camera. And in fact, you can change your camera view. So up here in the panel, I click away from it. On the current view, you see under the scene menu, the current view is selected. On the properties panel, here's our view, and custom view. We can say, actually, I like this view. Let's call this view, this is nice. And we can jump to any other view. We could go to the front, so that views it absolutely flat down on the ground plane. We could look at it from the top, so looking straight down on it like this.
Give it a second. Or we these updates seem to be taking the webinar a little bit of time to catch up with.
Okay.
We're still looking at the front view here. Now we're at the top. Okay.
And when you go to these views, you're looking at it as an orthographic view, so it's not a perspective view. And that's worth remembering. So if you now rotate it, you think, wow, that looks weird. That's because we're still using an orthographic view and not a perspective view. Is that updated yet? Can you see
that? Yes.
Good. So we can now switch this to perspective view, and that looks much more like a real object. And however much we do with it, we can say, okay, you know, I like that view we had earlier. Let's go back to that. So we go to the view menu, go back to this is nice, and it should. There we go. Take a straight back.
Give us a second. There's evidently a lot of computation going on here for the webinar software. Now that, there we go. Okay. I was going to say, it did not look like it. I just wanted to, it just took a second to update.
So let's add another object. And in fact, there are several ways of doing this. We could, within this scene, go to our little 3D panel and add an object from here. In fact, I need to go, there we go, add objects. We could add a cone or a cube or whatever, and it'll just appear in here. But let's make a new object from scratch instead, because that's just more interesting.
For you.
So we'll make a new layer, and we'll call this, I'll make a vase, because I like making vases. Sorry, would you call it a vase?
I would definitely call it a vase, unless I was trying to sound pretentious.
Oh, is that right?
It happens. That does actually happen.
Ah. Oh, I had no idea. I didn't realize I was having protection by calling it a vase. I can't call it a vase. I can't bring myself to say that. So I'm going to call it something else. I'll make a glass. Can I make a glass? Or do I have to call it a glass?
Again?
This language thing is so complicated.
I wouldn't worry about it.
So I'm going to hide.
Because you're British. You don't sound pretentious when you say it. You sound British. I sound pretentious when I say it.
Well,
I'm trying to sound
British.
That
is pretentious, isn't it? So let's make this, and I'm going to start this by doing a bit of a vertical line here for the stem. And I'm going to go, as I'm using the pen tool to draw my outline, and I want quite a nice, thick kind of vase shape.
We have a show up on YouTube all about you showing how to use the pen tool for the people that aren't familiar with it.
Indeed we do. So there we go. And good. So for some reason I've inadvertently drawn a shape here, but that's okay. I've drawn a shape because I had shape selected rather than path. Let us now hit create, and it's going to make a 3D object out of that. And there's our 3D object. It's not what I wanted because it's extruded it. I didn't want to extrude it. I wanted to revolve it. It's also done it, because I had a, I'm going to start this again.
That looks like an expensive book stand.
I'm going to go back and make sure I'm drawing a path, and this time I'm going to think about it and do it a bit more properly. I'm going to draw a biggish sort of balloon-shaped glass, because that's the kind of glass I want.
I would have been happy with a cone.
Oh, you'd have been happy with a cone. I'm not happy with a cone. Cones, cone is boring.
I just want to know how to put a ball on a cube by the end of this show. I would be a happy.
Oh, we'll do that as well. But what I'm showing here, so there is our object. So we're going to say create new object with the 3D panel. We're going to use the work path and create. And there is our object, and you can see it simply extruded that shape. So I'm not going to do a whole tutorial on this. I'm just going to show you quickly. What I'm going to do is, in the properties, I'm going to set the extrusion to 0, so it has no depth. I'm going to set the bend to 360 degrees. You can see it revolving there. Mm-hmm. Yep. And what's happening, it's rotating around the middle of the object. So in this deformation axis, I'm going to say, no, rotate it around the right-hand side. And there is our glass.
Goblet.
It's actually a a vase, but I'm not going to say that because it sounds pretentious. So we're going to call it a glass.
Looks like you chose wisely.
So I'm going to take this and I want to merge this down with our 3D layer, our Pro underneath. And in order to get this and the Pro into the same environment, well, we have to go to layer, and this is really surprising, but it's merged down. Now, with any other Photoshop object, if you merge layers together, then you flatten the layers. With 3D, it doesn't work like that. When I hit merge down now, it drops those down together, and what it's done is it puts them both into the same 3D layer.
Okay, so I am not being... This is not my imagination. Photoshop is being willfully obtuse when it comes to 3D.
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. There's a whole team at Adobe devoted to trying to fool Doug Nelson.
Absolutely. I've suspected it for years. It has been confirmed in front of an audience.
So, now the glass, when we made it, was perfectly straight. When we merged the two layers together, you can see, it's come out of this bizarre angle. Why is it that size rather than smaller? Well, you can get around this by setting this actually the same camera for each of your scenes before you merge the layers together. Actually, it doesn't matter. We can just click on it, select it, go to our coordinates, and let's say reset coordinates.
Hang on one second. Again, we're having some trouble with the screen lag here. Give us a second here to catch up with it. Okay, there we're seeing it, and all you did was you hit the reset coordinates button, and now we have
your... And so that simply straightened up that glass, so it's now at least in the same orientation as the lettering.
Right.
If we move it to the ground, it's going to come up here. What I want to do is I want to place the Pro lettering so that it intersects with this glass.
It looks like it's already intersecting.
As if it's printed on the side of it.
Ah, okay.
So let's bring this up. Okay, I want to rotate it around. How do I do that?
Click outside of it.
Tell me.
You didn't tell me there was going to be...
I want to rotate the lettering. I don't want it flat anymore. I want it vertical.
You didn't tell me there'd be a quiz.
If you go, my mission tonight is to teach you.
But sir,
forget about everyone else who's watching.
But
to
sir,
teach you how to use 3D. So there are two ways of doing it. One way is to go over the edge and rotate it. What's the other way?
The little gizmo in the middle there.
The little gizmo in the middle there, as you put it.
Is there an
so
there
we
a
can
name
rotate that round as well?
Is there a name for that thing?
It's a 3D axis.
No, I mean the gizmo in the middle.
Oh, no, it's called the gizmo in the middle. Actually, I have no idea what it's called. But
trademark
the gizmo in the middle is a good thing.
RetouchPRO.
So, and as we look at the properties panel of the coordinates, we can see, actually, that's down to 3.9 degrees. That's not bad, but let's set it to zero because then it's going to be more appropriate. Mm-hmm. And we'll bring this forward. There we go. And let's make it smaller so it's a decent size to go on here. And we can move it up. Now, the problem we get is...
Slow down here. We're getting with the redraw situation here.
Okay.
Well, let's give it a second here. Okay, now we're looking straight on at it. It looks like you're rotating it a little bit.
That's right. So I brought it, so we're looking straight on. The problem we get now is, how do we know where this is in 3D space relative to that glass behind it? It's actually quite difficult to do. So this is where the secondary view comes in. It will be on show by default. I usually put it away because I find it gets in the way. Go to the view menu, go down to show, and 3D secondary view. And that pops up this view in the corner. At the moment, we are looking straight down on this.
Ah, okay.
Yep. We can change our view, so we're looking at it from the right. That's quite good for this one. So now, as we drag this text, we can see exactly how far away it is. And when we have it just there, well, we can see that is now intersecting with our glass.
So there is no what they call collision detection going on in here.
No.
Okay.
We don't have that luxury.
So, for the people in the audience that don't know what that is, the objects don't know each other exist, and so they, whenever you draw them, they are completely oblivious that there is anything else existing in that particular world.
Well, they know it exists in the sense of, if I keep on sliding it, you can see it's going to go inside the glass, and the text gets hidden by the glass because it's on the inside. So from that point of view, Photoshop knows that the other objects exist. The objects themselves don't know they exist.
Kind of like ghosts floating around.
Yeah, exactly. So the problem now is we want to bend this lettering around so that we have our three letters, one, the P, the R, and the O, so they all sort of fit neatly on the face of this glass. First of all, let's extrude this just a little bit more so that it's a bit deeper. There we go. So now it actually reaches inside the glass. How do we make this text bend around? Well, there's good news and there's bad news. This is something people want to do a lot in Photoshop. The bad news is it can't be done.
Cool.
The good news is, of course it can be done. Here's how it works. We've got our Word Pro. I'm going to edit that. So I'm going to go into, get that selected. Okay, we're now on the mesh itself. That's the first batch of settings in the properties panel. I'm going to click on Edit Source, and that will open this in the new window. Mm-hmm. I'm going to delete the P and the 0 and the O. Yep. When I save this, it's going to save that back into our thing, and there it is. There's the R by itself. So when I select that, I can now move that and think, yeah, it's quite a nice place for it. We can see as we're looking from the top that it is embedding itself quite neatly into the glass. We could change this to a left view. Yep, you can see it's all actually reaching nicely inside there. To get the other letters, the only way of doing it is to duplicate it. So let's duplicate this object. It's done. We can't see the difference because it's duplicated directly on top. So let's move it to the side. Let's edit this one. And we can call this, change that to a P. Once again, we'll close this PSB window, save it, and there's the P. And we can now take that P, we can rotate it. Now, when we rotate it, we want to rotate it around which axis?
Why?
Yes, excellent. And how do we do that?
You would rotate around the y-axis. You want to drag the little X arm on that gizmo in the center?
We can. It's a little hard to get to. There's a simpler way. Simply go over any of the vertical edges in it.
Okay.
And we can rotate it that way.
All right.
Yep. While we're doing that, let's have a look at the top view on here, on the secondary view. And now we can see exactly how much to rotate it. That's pretty good. Okay, so that is now perpendicular to the face of the glass at that point. It's standing out a bit too far. How do we slide it back?
That would be the z-axis.
Well, it would be the z-axis. How do we slide it on the z-axis?
You grab the top edge.
No, we grab a face.
Face, okay.
As we move over the front face, you can see the orange highlight, and dragging on there will slide it on this axis.
I warned you I was stupid about this, and you are simply underscoring that fact, so thank you for that.
No, that is not the intention. My mission tonight is to get you to understand this stuff. So, it is simpler than you think. If you go on a face, then you drag it perpendicular to that face. If you go on an edge, you drag it around that edge. It's as simple as that.
I think it's simple once you've had years of practice.
Yeah, could be. Anyway, let's finish off the lettering. Let's make another duplicate of this. duplicate the object. There's our new one. I'm going to move that over way over here. And I want to change this, of course, to an O. So I'll go into the Properties panel, edit the source, O, close the window, save it. There we go. So are you going to tell me how to do this? Or should I just show you?
Show us.
Okay. So you want to rotate it, first of all. So we go over one of the vertical edges, and we can rotate it. And it's fairly clear when you see those orange highlights that you're rotating it around, you know, around that vertical.
Once I remember that those are there, yes, you're right. It is, but you know, but this is a whole new thing, and I'm still edging along the bottom of of the learning curve here. So just half the battle for me is remembering that they even exist.
Okay. Well, one thing I didn't show you is if you go over a face, you move it parallel to that face or perpendicular to that face. If you go over an edge, you move it parallel to that edge. If you go exactly on an edge, you move it on the plane perpendicular to that edge that you went over. So here, we're moving it on the XZ plane.
I think that might be one of the elemental things is because even though you've got multiple things here, again, none of them know the others exist, and so you're not moving something, as far as it's concerned, in relative position to anything else. It is only moving in an absolute geometric a position in some theoretical space. You know, it's not, it doesn't even know there's a ground plane there. The fact that the ground plane is oriented correctly is simply the default value. You could change that if you felt like it.
That is absolutely true. The really important thing to remember is that the XY and Z axis of the object is particular just to that object and not to the world.
We've got to reiterate that because I think that is something that a little light bulb just went off for me. There is no absolute X, Y, or Z. There is only object to object to object X, Y, and Z.
Well, there is an absolute, and the absolute is the camera.
But again, that's another object.
Yeah, exactly. Well, the camera is another object. Indeed, that's a good way of looking at it. And since the camera is another object, well, why not think of the lighting as being another object?
There we
go. So to change the lighting, you can just click on the light, the only one light in here, and there we go. This is the light control. And now you can drag this light around, and you can get some really cool effects by dragging this light.
Now, are the handles of the light always visible no matter where the light actually ends up?
Yes.
Okay.
The light is always visible up the top there.
Because I would swear that sometimes I can't get to the light handle.
Sometimes, okay, it can be over there. So at the moment, the light is hidden behind the secondary
That's
view.
That's going to be the only time.
So you think, how do we get to that? Well, the way to get to it is hold the shift key and click on the shadow. No, hold the command key and click on the shadow. Just click on the shadow. Click on the shadow. Hang on, let's select our object. Right. Yeah, hold the shift key and click on the shadow.
Oh, that's clever.
And then the
I
light
like that. Shift shadow. And physically click on the actual shadow. Of course, if we don't have a ground plane, we're screwed on that.
No. The ground plane is always there. Even if we hide that that ground plane, the object is still on the ground.
Okay.
All we're hiding is the grid.
Okay.
Generally, you're probably going to, if you're combining multiple objects particularly, and especially if you're working with shadows, you are certainly going to want to have that ground plane visible because it just shows you where everything is located.
Yeah, it keeps you oriented. It makes things a lot more intuitive.
Yeah. Okay, so there is our object. How are we feeling about manipulating this?
A little bit better. Janet wants to know, can everything you just showed us be done in CS6?
Yes, everything can be done in CS6 except for these little controls on the bottom here. They are only in CC.
There are some control interface tweaks, but as far as the commands and all the steps and everything, that's going to be the same for CS6.
Other than that, that's identical. Yep. So you'll have no trouble whatsoever with that.
Oh, I just want to, well, since I did pause you here a second, I just wanted to take a second to remind everybody that if you want to upload any images, get busy because otherwise they will not be here in time for Steve to help you with them. And so whenever he's done here, we'll be able to answer any questions you might have. And if you want to upload some images, I just pasted the link into the questions box. So if we want.
Do you want to put a ball on top of this
I know
glass?
I want to. Can you move the. If you want to put another object in there, do you have to
Yep.
start a new world, or can you just move that to the side and move and make something else, or do you always need to have your zero? Do you
Okay.
always have to have your zero zero, your I guess zero 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 on your object?
No, we can always go back to the scene. We can add an object to this. We can add
Cube. Add a cube.
one of these primitives.
Add a cube.
You're on a
I
cube.
want a
Okay,
dumb
let's
a
put it on
dumb
a
old
cube.
cube.
Okay. There's our cube.
So right now it is
It's a
it's merged with our goblet.
it hasn't merged
Well,
with
it's
it,
hidden it
but it
on
is
top of it.
certainly.
They're coexisting in the same
Yeah.
space.
Now, although you might think a cube is a simple object, actually, in Photoshop, it isn't. So, if we select the cube, we can say, "Okay, let's move this cube and let's bring it forwards a bit." And you think that's all going to be fine. The trouble is, we're only moving the front face of the cube. That's because when you make a cube in Photoshop, each face is a separate object.
Ah, that again, here we go. That might be one of the elementary
Okay,
problems I've
so
had.
that's going to really confuse people. So, if you want to move the whole cube, then we just click on the cube here in the 3D panel. That will select everything inside the cube, and now we can use, well, the scale control in the middle,
That would be helpful right now.
scale that cube down, and now, well, we probably want to reset the coordinates. It's moved itself down the bottom there for no good reason. There it is. So we can hang that in the middle of our goblet. And because we created it in here, it will be automatically centered on the on this
Can you
ground
do me a
plane.
favor? Instead of putting it into the goblet, can we ignore the goblet and just set it on the floor next to the goblet?
Absolutely. So let's now move it to the ground.
The ground,
There we
not the
go.
floor. To me, I see, I still think of it as a floor.
Well, it's a floor. What's the difference between a floor and a ground? The ground is outdoors and the floor is indoors.
Floor exists and a ground is an imaginary construct of X, Y, and Z coordinates. That doesn't really exist, yet I can still see it.
Yeah, okay, I can see the difficulty you're having. Let's make it a little bit bigger and move it to the ground
Now
again. And just
okay,
to,
go ahead. Go
yep.
ahead. No, go ahead.
Well, just to show what we can do with it, if we click on just the front face here, you can see the bounding box actually is no longer bounding the entire thing, but we can move that front face around
So the
independently.
faces
So
themselves can have size and thickness and okay.
they can't have thickness, but they can have
Okay.
position.
I thought we were
With a cube, the faces are of infinite thinness.
okay, that's fine by me. That's fine. Now I want to put a ball, a sphere, squarely and exactly and not kind of guessworkingly. I want it to be to the like it would be in the real world, exactly and specifically resting upon the top of that box.
Okay, that's a good idea. Well, first of all, let us grab this cube and let's change the color
Is
of
there a
it,
way to lock it
because
so we don't have to worry about that all the faces moving and stuff? Is there a way to lock it as an object?
no,
Okay.
that would be good, wouldn't
You
it?
can't like merge it or something. I guess we could have
Why is a color
I
not
guess we could have
changed?
made a plane and extruded it ourselves and then it would have been a real cube.
Yeah, we could have done it that way, but a cube in Photoshop is a particular kind
Yeah, no.
of
It's not
thing.
really a cube. It's something called a primitive, which is what it's designed to be able to do other things with.
Exactly.
I'm aware.
Let's okay, yeah. So I was trying to change the color of this cube. For some reason, it wasn't letting me do that. And I don't know why that
Worry,
is,
that's
because I
another
have
show.
all my
Anyway,
materials
if we get
selected.
enough demand from the users watching this and watching on YouTube, we will have another show on materials and colors and all this other good stuff. So don't worry, you're off the hook there.
Okay, fine. So there's our cube. We wanna, let's put another object in. So we can go to, we need to go
to a sphere.
Out of this
Now, is a
cube,
sphere not
let's
really
go.
a sphere?
A sphere, you'll be delighted to hear, is a sphere.
It only has one face.
Indeed. We've got those all grouped, haven't we? Yes. So let us go to add objects, sphere. And, you know, it's giving you this 3D scene size in millimeters, of all things, millimeters.
You can change that, can't you?
A lot of the advances in Photoshop at the moment are to do with 3D printing, and that's what all this stuff is for. Frankly, just say yes.
You can change it to pixels.
Okay.
You can change it to...
As you can see, it's come out a little bigger than we expected. So...
How do we recover? Yeah, this is a perfect example of something that would happen when I was working. How do you recover from something like this?
That's a good question. Well, I guess what we have to do is to zoom out. There we go. That's a very big sphere. And let's scale the whole thing uniformly. Out about there. That's quite a good size. And in our second review, let's pan across. There is our cube. So we'll move it across. So now it's directly on top of our cube. Yep, because we're looking directly above.
You can't just drop it to the cube. You have to drop it. The only thing it can drop to is the ground.
That's right. So we bring it down. As we bring it down, you can see there's the shadow moving closer to the cube.
I have to admit, that's kind of cool.
So now let's zoom in.
Or we could just restore that camera preset we made.
We could do that. Let's go back to our views and go back to this is nice. There you go. That was the original view that we had. No longer.
Give us a second to update.
Strictly
there
relevant.
We go. Yeah, but it's there if we wanted to make one.
Exactly. Yeah. And so now we can pan this across, and we can rotate it. So there is our sphere and our cube. How do we get it directly on top?
Yeah, I know you can drag it until it's kind of sort of there and all that, but I want it to actually be sitting on there so that if I got really good at this and I wanted to make that a walnut sphere on a granite block, it would look real. It wouldn't look like something's adjacent.
Oh, okay. All right. So what I'm going to do then is... all right, the easiest way is going to be if we take all of these objects and just move them all the way out of the way so that they're not going to interfere. In fact, we could hide them. No, we'll leave them there because it might want to come back to them later. Let's go back. So we'll take the cube and let's... reset the coordinates, so it puts it back there, make it bigger again, and move it to the ground. But we know it is now directly centered on our axis. We can take the sphere, and we want to reset the position of this, not the size. Yep, there it is, directly centered on the ground. So let's select the top face of this cube.
Okay.
And when we look here, we can see that the Y position is 805.6.
Y is up to down, right?
805.6 what? I have no idea. I don't care. Let's select our sphere, and let's set the Y position to 805.6.
Is that going to work, or is that the center of the sphere?
No, it's not, because it's the center. Oh, how irritating. Okay, so what is the diameter of this sphere? I don't know. Is it going to tell me on here? 150. Well, that can't be right. Oh, well, okay. 1549.76.
Really, you want the height of the cube, don't you? Or no, because
yeah.
You still couldn't. And then.
The center of this sphere.
See,
I'm just
that you're having problems here, because that means that it is not as simple as you would like us to think.
Well, no, we can do it. It'll take a little bit of a calculation,
And
but how's your mental arithmetic? So,
horrible, horrible.
what is? Do you happen to know what's half of 1,549.76? Tell you what, I am going to change these
Do
numbers.
it.
I'm going to make it to 1,500,
There you go.
and I'm assuming that is the diameter of the sphere. Look at that. It's made the X 1,500.01.
Rounding error.
Listen, sometime Photoshop, you think they're just, having a laugh. Okay, so
It's that
half of
committee.
that is 750. 805.6 plus 750 is 1,555.6. Oh, it didn't do it. Hang on. 805 plus 750 is 1,500. That's the 8 and
Not
the 7.
55, just 50.
1,500, 1,555.6. Enter. There we go. And that is how easy it is to put a sphere on top of a
Well, now you can
cube.
see, being a Photoshop user, I'm not thinking about objects, and I'm not thinking about this thing, a plane
Well,
floating in
neither
space.
am I. Being a Photoshop
I'm think
user,
I
being a
know.
Photoshop user, I set the sphere to the size I
Trying to be
wanted.
an audience proxy here.
I have a look here. I view it from the, let's say, from the front, and I just drag it until being a, as a Photoshop user, as you say, until it looks like it's in the right
Okay.
place. And for a Photoshop user, if it looks like it's in the right place, it's in the right place, because that's what Photoshop's about. You're the one who started going all technical about what's exactly on
It's not
top
going to be.
with your talk of
It's
granite
not going to
resting
be the
on
first
marble
time. It's
surfaces.
not going to be the first time. There
Okay.
wouldn't be a show if I wasn't like that.
No, I guess that's true. So there we go. That is okay. That's it's perhaps sinking into it very slightly. So we'll have to raise it up there. I'm going to say that is pretty close.
Because
What do you think?
later on, if like I say, if we're just if we're trying to make a real world image, an image that a virtual reality image that we can render later on and is indistinguishable from a real world. And I've tried this, and I've actually gotten fairly far along in the process. But the last half a pixel alignment or whatever screwed up, and just what it the uncanny valley, it just immediately threw the whole eye off the scene.
Yes. No, it absolutely did. I agree with that completely. And it is unfortunate.
Okay.
But you can get a bit too technical with this, can't you? What I'm going to do now is just bring this in, rotate this around, and I think spin it around so it's lying on the ground. The goblet tossed there after an evening of debauchery.
Carelessly, yes. The RetouchPRO cup.
Exactly. Good.
Marvelous. I don't know. Is there any? I mentioned that we might save this file, but I don't really know if there's going to be any use here to save this. I don't know if the audience would care to be able to download this file. If that would be any use to them or not.
I wouldn't have thought so, but I'm just illustrating actually another rather difficult thing here, which is, I guess, what you've been talking about. So we've got this, and I want this cup lying on its
Yep.
side. How do we know when it's actually lying on its
There you
side?
go.
Well, all we have to do really is to change our viewpoint so we can see it there, and
How do you zoom in the secondary viewpoint?
By holding the Z, holding the Alt key down, and you just zoom in and
They
out.
couldn't put a button on there. Google Maps can put a button to zoom, and they can't put a button on there.
Okay, one thing you can also do is this button up here swaps the main view with the secondary view, so you can always switch between
Oh, now
them
that's handy. That could be
if you want to.
useful.
That's quite cool. So now we can see that the back end, the base of this goblet is actually slightly below the ground plane, so I can rotate it there. And okay, now we can
So you
see.
can see I wasn't necessarily just being recreationally anal.
Indeed, you weren't. No, they were very valid points you were making.
Why does it look like the shadow is hollow? That shadow looks weird. I don't really care.
It does look weird, doesn't
this
it?
This isn't a shadow show. We're going to have a you know, if there's a sufficient demand, we'll have a show on shadows, but it's just odd looking. It's just an artifact of the rendering.
It is. Let's try a quick render of this. And
is there such thing? While this is happening, talk a little
bit. There we go. It was just the preview of the shadow that was looking
there
weird
go.
And not
there
the
go. While this is rendering, itself. To give it a second to look semi-okay, talk a little bit about speed requirements and video cards and things along those lines in regards to...
Yeah, 3D in Photoshop is very, very processor intensive. When CC came out, I had to buy a new laptop in order to be able to go and give demos about 3D stuff in
now
CD.
Now, is this all GPU accelerated and stuff?
It is absolutely GPU accelerated. It uses their Mercury engine,
okay.
Which
like
as they call it, which Adobe are very proud of.
Yeah. So if we've got a relatively modern, like a gamer card or whatever, this should be okay.
Oh yeah, absolutely, because a lot of what games are doing is precisely that kind of a 3D.
But it has to be a card like
play.
From the last 2 years, though, because I have one a little bit older than that, and the technology completely skips it by.
No, I think that's right. But the results are really worth it. I mean, even here, we've applied no textures to any objects, but have a look at what it's doing here, which I think is really impressive. We've got this sphere very nicely lit. There's the light source up the
like
top there. There's
sphere.
A shadow.
That
but
is...
also, underneath, we've got the reflection
like
of the surface, upper surface of the cube on the sphere. And that's what makes it look
there's
real. That little splash
what's
of light.
For that? There's a word for that. A 3D word. Audience?
Ambience?
Well, ambience is a real world word, but I thought there was a 3D term.
Specularity.
Specularity. There we go. I think that's
yeah.
There's all sorts of things. Because in 3D, you have to worry about, not only do you have to worry about opacity, but you have to worry about transparency, translucency, a thing called subscatter, which is the transparency only of the surface. And again, if there's sufficient demand, we'll get into those shows in the future. But
okay, well, stuff like subsurface scattering, you don't have to worry about because Photoshop can't do it.
Well, I guess that's why they like working with it so easily exports to like Cinema 4D and things along those lines.
Exactly. Subsurface scattering is the fact it's particularly used for skin, and it relates to the fact that when light bounces off people's skin, it doesn't bounce off the surface because the surface is transparent or translucent, but it bounces off the layer beneath the epidermis, and that's what gives skin its very particular
basically
quality.
Basically, any non-opaque thing. Like we did a show a couple weeks ago that had mentioned tennis shoes, and I've heard that when you're rendering things along those lines, it comes just anything that has anything that's not basically not shiny. Really has subsurface scattering.
Yeah.
Potentially, or can
yep.
have it. Anyhow, Gregory wants to know if radiosity is the term we're looking for.
It could well be. It's not a Photoshop term, so maybe Photoshop can't do it. I would like to stress at this point that while I really love all the 3D stuff that Photoshop can do, I have never managed to get my head around Cinema 4D or 3ds Max or ZBrush or Maya or in fact any of those
things.
I've
I gotta
always
tell you,
hated
if
all
anybody
them.
Is looking to get into the real 3D part, most of those companies that you just mentioned and another one that makes a product called View, they have free learning editions that are basically unlimited. There's no, you know, no restrictions on it, and they don't expire or whatever, but they're limited as to the size and that you can do and things along those lines. So if you want to pursue it, but they can import the files that Photoshop makes and things along those lines. I think there's a Cinema 4D Learning Edition. What's the, not Maya, the other one for that started on Windows. Oh, heck. But anyway,
3DS?
3DS.
3DS Max?
Yeah, 3DS, yeah. That has a learning edition. There are several others out there. View and Modo are two that are particularly beloved by a lot of advertising and product people, although Cinema 4D really seems to be the market leader as far as working with Photoshop and trying to create photorealistic things. I mean, you could do, there's also freeware open source apps like Blender and things along those lines, but I'm just talking.
Can I point out that if you are a subscriber to the Adobe CC full all you can eat edition, so not just the Photoshop and Lightroom, but the full CC suite, then you have access to After Effects.
Yes.
And within After Effects, you can launch a cut-down version of Cinema 4D.
Ah, okay. Well, that's cool.
It is good. You can't use it independently of After Effects. So they give it to you free, but they kind of tie one hand behind your back while you're using it.
It would give you a taste of it, though. But like I say,
but it gives you a good taste
I do believe
it.
There is a learning edition. We can. This is maybe a good thing to talk about in our 3D forum. People can give their opinions and links or whatever. You go to retouchpro.com and go to our 3D forum and start conversations in there about other non-Photoshop 3D apps that play well with Photoshop. Strata 3D used to market themselves as the Photoshop-like 3D app, and I think they failed market-wise. But the interface does look a little bit like Photoshop, so that's another one that people might want to check out. It's also nice because it does export very well to Photoshop. Although from Photoshop, they all have little problems with there. And then there's always the favorite of a lot of Photoshoppers is like Poser and the Daz 3D environments, Bryce for the landscapes, things along those lines.
And of course, you can import objects from Cinema 4D, from Poser, from Daz Studio into Photoshop. And of course, anything you create in Photoshop, you can then export as a DXF or as an OBJ file. You can then import them from there into Cinema 4D as well.
If there is sufficient demand in the comments, if there is sufficient demand in the forum, we might even possibly even do a future show on some of those. If you're on YouTube right now, mention it in the comments or go to retouchpro.com. Go to the 3D forum, start a thread there, or if somebody else has already done it, participate in theirs. But this is something that I personally am very curious about, but have not really found any good resources, points of entry into getting into this. And if Retouch Pro Live can end up being that point of entry for other people, I'm happy to come along for the ride. Is there anything else 3D related we need to talk about today?
Oh, there's a huge amount that we can talk about,
but I'm talking about just whenever you're talking about balls on boxes on ground planes.
Yeah, I think don't panic is the first thing to say. If you find yourself getting a bizarre view of an object that's far bigger than you want that you can't manipulate, well, don't worry about that. Actually, what we didn't look at was are these buttons along the top. We should have a quick look at those. I'm going to cancel this render. Pretty though it was. And that's going to show you these, because we didn't look at these at all. They're very, very quickly. The reason I didn't look is because the first one is the orbit tool, and that's the one that you're going to use most of all. So you use that. Let's have a look at just on the background. As you drag that, that rotates the whole scene
okay.
around. Next to that, the scene. Well, the object, if you click on an object, or the scene, if you don't have an object selected.
But we do need to differentiate there.
We do. Okay, the roll tool. So let's select, well, I can't roll a sphere because you won't see the difference. Let's select this goblet group. The roll tool, which is the next one, spins it around. And it spins it around the z-axis of the world.
Oh, and now you're...
So you see this blue line here? That is the z-axis of the world we're looking at. And as I spin it, it's rotating it around that axis.
Mashing my melon, man.
You see, this is why I didn't want to talk about these ones too much.
Yeah.
The next one will let us drag the object around and this drags it parallel to the x-axis of the world, so not of the object itself.
We'll call that the skid tool.
We can call it the skin tool. It's actually called the drag tool.
Oh, close enough.
The next one is the slide tool, and this drags it kind of. I've never really got the hang of this tool. It drags it around vaguely. You know, it just.
I am pleased that there are tools that you don't care for or like in there. That makes me feel so much.
This is
better.
A pretty crazy tool. And the final one is simply the scale tool, and that'll just make it bigger.
Okay.
So the scale. So that's the reason I didn't talk about these tools, because frankly, the only one you usually want to use is this. Occasionally, you may want to use the roll.
Glad you mentioned them, but let's put them out of our mind and obey what your recommendation there about only using the one primary.
Yeah, so the thing is, as I say, don't panic. If you want to do something like put the sphere precisely on top of the cube, well, yeah, you can do it. You can work out where the top of the cube is, work out the diameter of the sphere, which is going to show you down here anyway, then work out what half the diameter is, then add that to the height of that.
It would be so much simpler if they just had collision detection, if they knew each other existed, and you could just say, drop the sphere on the box, and we'd be done with it.
It would.
Okay.
Maybe that will come, and that would certainly be. It would certainly be useful, of course.
I just want to let everybody know.
But remember that. Remember two things. Firstly, that 3D in Photoshop is still really in its infancy.
It's very rudimentary. Yes.
Yeah, it's still fairly rudimentary. There's so much that you can't do with 3D tools in Photoshop. For example, you know, in order to bend this simple text around the goblet, I had to split it into individual letters. That's irritating. It should be a way of bending the whole lot. There are lots of limitations.
Harold did mention you could split the extrusion.
That's what I did, isn't it?
No, you copied and renamed it, and you basically made a new one with the different content.
How could I split the extrusion?
I don't know. That's between you and Carol.
Okay. Carol, we might have to talk about this later.
Carol's got another question that I think might stump you. Oh, good. Well, you had another point you wanted to make.
This is, above all, this is Photoshop. And while you can create all these objects in Photoshop, and you can do interesting things with them, if you're working on a montage and you want a picture of a Sherman tank or the Statue of Liberty.
Which we did. That's what I was getting ready to say. We've got shows. Symbol. We've got shows up on YouTube right now. YouTube.com/RetouchPro. In one of them, you put a triceratops in a forest?
Yeah, exactly.
And another one, you put a tank on the White House lawn, and I didn't read anything into that. but those were kind of the proto inspiration for today's show.
Yeah, so you know that is the real strength of Photoshop, its ability to bring in objects from outside, and that you can get 3D objects so easily. There's some great sources out there, and bring them in and work with them. What we've been doing here, yeah, the modeling tools are limited.
I want to do another show where we put a ball on a real photo ground and then take whatever steps are necessary. To heck with triceratops and tanks and things along those lines. I just want to make a photorealistic ball sitting on a lawn somewhere.
Okay, that we could do.
Maybe that'll be 3D too. Maybe.
Yeah, let's do that. Let's do that in 2 weeks' time.
Let's do that. Carol wants to know, and I'm just going to read this because this is way beyond my pay grade, what's the difference between the two environment folders? When do we use each?
Oh, there's only one.
Carol.
Environment.
Carol would beg to differ.
Where is the second one? There's this environment and the scene.
There's one. Carol says there's one down below also for each mesh. There we go.
Oh, okay. Oh, right. That is...
Below externals?
Okay, the environment there is for creating reflections and refractions.
So that would be like if you wanted to load an image that would take the place of the photographer so you could reflect it back if we were doing like specular highlights and things along those lines.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Exactly. The environment tab up here, this is the default environment map that we're working with. You can replace this. Okay, this is to do with the image based lighting.
Yes. Which is a thing. IBL is a huge thing. If you're interested, Google it, because that is a massive, massive, massive topic all on its own.
Very much. When we do our show on placing a sphere on the glass, we will absolutely be using image-based lighting in there, and we'll certainly be looking at how to use the two different environments.
Can we make it a stone or a sphere, and then make it a metal sphere?
Yes, of course, we can do all that stuff.
Have time to do that is what I meant. Can you do that in an hour?
Yes.
Can you add a glass sphere so that we can see the grass through it and things?
Yes and no.
Okay.
Yes, we can do it in an hour, but it will probably take an hour to render.
If anybody's watching this on YouTube within the next 2 weeks and they're wanting to see that show, make sure you go to retouchpro.com and register so that you will get the invitation, or you can just watch the Retouch Pro Live forum over at retouchpro.com if you want to make sure to be able to attend that show so that you can ask your own questions. And I'll give, while I'm vamping here, I'll give anybody else a time to type in any questions that they want. Gamma asked about compositing with a 3D photo, but I think the show in 2 weeks, I think, is going to cover that.
Yeah. Indeed. Okay. Anything else?
Let's see here. Paul wants to know, what spec is your particular Mac that you're using right now for today's show?
Okay, I'm using a 27-inch iMac. I bought it about 8 months ago, so it's not that old. I bought it in 2014. I have 64 gigabytes of RAM.
Wow.
Because
that's just cheating.
Because it really makes a difference.
Of course it does. That's just cheating.
And in my daily workflow, I will be running Photoshop and InDesign and Illustrator and often After Effects, and I want to run them all at the same time.
Your RAM costs twice as much as my entire computer.
RAM has got cheaper. Much cheaper.
My...
Or you have a very cheap computer.
Both. And what about your video? What's the video card that comes in there?
I have no idea. It's whatever was in there when I bought
okay,
it.
Okay, I want to say something here to everybody. Whenever Adobe says 3D accelerated, they mean NVIDIA. They can't say that because they would be sued into oblivion. But if you're looking at getting a new card...
Oh, sorry, 32 gigs of RAM. My mistake.
That's a little bit better. But you can see there that he that that is seriously. If you are talking about upgrading your card and your interest is primarily for 3D and Photoshop and things along those, or anything Adobe, Premiere, anything Adobe, NVIDIA. I mean, AMD makes or ATI or whoever they are nowadays. They make excellent cards. But Adobe, whenever they say 3D accelerated, they mean NVIDIA. They really do. They just can't say it. So that, I'm doing them a little favor there. So let's see here. Are there any other specifications for your particular machine that would be relevant to what we're trying to talk about today or the next show?
No, not really. I mean, the faster the processor, the faster things like rendering are going to be. And rendering is a thing that does take the time, but then you can always render a small part of a model. You don't have to render the whole thing. So, for example, if you had this goblet here and decided I want to actually make it out of glass, since we called it a glass, then I can just go down and I can choose, I don't know, one of the default glass textures, and I can say, okay, how is that going to look? I don't want to have to render the whole scene, so I can just switch to my marquee tool and grab a section of this, and I can say render now, and when I do a render, it's going to render just that small section.
Cute.
So it's going to be able to do that very much more quickly.
Okay.
It'll think about it before it gets started, but there you go. And, you know, almost instantly, you can see roughly how that's going to look.
Now, is the rendering, is that more of the CPU or is that GPU? Assuming we have GPU available.
Yes, almost certainly. Okay. One or the other. I don't know this stuff. I'm not a mechanic. I'm a Photoshop artist. I don't know.
You're a photo illustrator. We decided.
I'm a photo illustrator. There we go.
We took a vote. Okay. Well, I think nobody's uploaded any images, sadly, but because I always enjoy that part of the show. But maybe next time. And tune in next time, where we will be throwing boulders on some unfortunate person's lawn and rendering them in 3D. Go to retouchpro.com to talk to us in the 3D forum. If you want to make sure that you're invited to future live shows, register at retouchpro.com or just watch the Retouch Pro Live subforum. Don't forget to rent our videos. But most importantly, and I'm sorry I'm harping on this, and I'm aware that I'm harping on this, but hey, it's my living. Become a patron. If you like the show, if you want to see more shows on this, if you want to see 3D7, the rendering or whatever, become a patron over at retouchpro.com. I just pasted a link in the box so you can click it and bookmark it for later reference, or just pull the trigger on it right now, please. Steve, you've got a book on 3D. Is it still relevant?
Yeah. It was a couple of years ago.
That sounds like a snarky question, but it's really not, because this stuff does change so fast.
Yeah, the book is written for Photoshop CC. It was written just before the 3D printing capabilities were announced. So although I knew about them, I wasn't allowed to talk about them, so which was kind of irritating at the time. But apart from 3D printing, all this stuff, the book is called 3D Photoshop.
Which is actually a lot harder to search for than you'd think. So just search, go to Amazon or your favorite bookseller and search for Steve Caplin. That's the easiest.
Let me find you a cover. Here we go. Here's version 9 of the cover. So we went through many, many different versions. I kept on tinkering with it.
There you go.
So what I like about this is that this cover illustration I put together entirely in Photoshop. The fish were modeled in Photoshop.
Cool.
The splash, the lettering, all that stuff.
I would love for our Photoshop, our 3D Photoshop forum, to be like the busiest 3D Photoshop forum anywhere on the internet. If we got enough people excited about it and posting in there, I think we could do that. And we could help anybody do wonderful images like this if we got enough activity and enough interest in that.
One thing I've just quite while we've got a few minutes, I say I made this entirely in Photoshop. I did make it entirely in Photoshop, and that is what it looked like when I made it. So all this other stuff that I added on top is simply adjustment layers to give it that little extra bit of zing.
Okay, so yeah, even though you make something in 3D, you might still want to do a lot of Photoshop post-processing in there.
Oh, certainly, yes.
Works in well to the Retouch
because,
Pro theme.
You know, because it took overnight to render this, and I'm not going to go back and make a little change and come back. I mean, I'm working in Photoshop. I want to enhance this image. Obviously, I'm going to use Photoshop to do that.
Marvelous.
I make absolutely no apology for doing that.
I think it's a good thing. Remember, it's retouchpro.com. Anything that brings in retouching and post-processing, hey, I'm all for it.
Yeah. So, You know, you by all means make stuff in 3D in Photoshop, but then throw Photoshop at it and make it look gorgeous.
I like that idea. Well, excellent. I'm going to call that a show, and now I'm really looking forward to our the next one where we throw boulders at some poor fellow's house. And become a patron, please. Rent our videos, please. But regardless, make sure you register at retouchpro.com so that you get invited to the future shows. Check this show out up on YouTube tomorrow, retouchpro.com/YouTube. Or if you're already there, feel free to go and look at all the other videos. Like I say, Steve put a triceratops in a forest, and he put a bulldozer on the White House lawn. You can check out those shows there along with all the others that we're doing. All right. Well, thanks for everyone for turning out today. Thanks for all the excellent questions. Wish we would have had some image uploads, but hey, maybe next time. And a special thank you to Steve Caplin for sharing with us this arcane and obscure and opaque, and I'm out of adjectives, knowledge about the 3D interface in Photoshop. Thanks, Steve.
Thank you, Doug. I hope you find it a little easier.
A little. I myself will be rewatching this video. All right. I will see everybody in the forums. Bye-bye, everyone.
Okay, bye.
Steve.